Hi folks, welcome back. I hope you're all doing well. Today I want to take a look at a paper that explores another very interesting point in the design space of virtual machines. And this system is called GiantVM. The paper was published back in March of 2020 in the Conference on Virtual Execution Environments. The title mentions that GiantVM is a type 2 hypervisor. So right away, let's talk about what these types of hypervisors are. A type 1 hypervisor is one that runs directly on the bare metal. It does not need support from an operating system, as opposed to a type 2 hypervisor, which runs on top of a host operating system and typically will utilize some of the underlying multiplexing and protection mechanisms offered by the host operating system. So this paper talks about type 2 hypervisors. Now, as the name suggests, the goal of the GiantVM system is to make it look so that your application has a huge amount of physical resources, but those physical resources are actually spread across many different physical machines. So GiantVM is the type 2 hypervisor that takes the RAM, CPU, storage from many physical machines and exposes it as a single abstraction that makes it look to the application running inside GiantVM that it is just running on one machine which has a ton of these resources. Now, why would you want to do this? If you have a very large application, you can pursue one of two strategies to run it. You can either scale up, which is to say, get a machine with a ton of resources. And this is typically what mainframes are for. Or you could scale out, which means you break your application into many smaller workers and then have some abstractions for dividing your work among those workers and recombining the results into a combined result. Now, each of these models has its own pros and cons. If you're scaling up, the price of these large mainframes becomes higher and higher. However, if you're scaling out, that typically means you have to re-architect your application to exploit parallelism in some way. But you can get more performance, which is to say you can get more resources for the same price. So the trade-off is that if you scale up, you pay more for the machine, but you can run your single address space application on that giant machine. Whereas if you scale out, you can get more resources for the same amount of money, but you will have to spend some engineering effort to re-architect your application to work on this multi-machine architecture. And this is where the idea of a single system image comes in, which is essentially the idea that you combine resources from many machines, but then make it look like one single machine to an application running on it. What the authors in this paper are proposing is to leverage QEMU running on top of KVM and modify it to offer a single system image abstraction. One of the advantages of doing this is that since QEMU KVM runs on top of a general purpose host operating system, in this case Linux, you're able to leverage the vast variety of device drivers that Linux already supports. And this lets you aggregate not just CPUs and memory, but also storage and I/O resources from a range of different physical machines. One crucial idea that the authors use is something called distributed shared memory. And this is the idea that you can have one large continuous virtual memory address on a single machine, but the physical memory backing that is actually spread across many different physical machines. The high-level architecture of GiantVM is that there is a hypervisor instance on each physical machine. And each of these instances creates a complete large virtual machine image using resources from a group of physical machines. And it has marked those resources according to whether they are remote, in which case reads and writes to those resources will get delegated, or whether they're local. From the point of view of the application running inside GiantVM, these are all just local resources. The exception to this local remote dichotomy is memory, which is shared by all instances throughout this giant VM. So let's quickly look at just some of the details for how they make this happen. Looking at CPUs, the giant VM abstraction can take threads and run it both on local vCPUs as well as remote vCPUs. And since memory is all one combined address space, they can all address the same memory. One thing to note is how you handle interrupts. And giant VM sets up an interrupt forwarding mechanism, which checks whether the interrupt is to a local vCPU or a remote vCPU. So they have logic to intercept these interrupts and delegate them to the correct virtual CPU. And that brings us to distributed memory. Now, the important thing to note here is that the way we provide this distributed shared memory abstraction must respect the x86 memory model. And that memory model is total store ordering. Now, the details of that model are a whole other video by itself, but this means that the way they implement DSM has to be at least as strong as TSO. At a very high level, each page in this distributed shared memory system has one of three states. It is either modified or shared or invalid. If you have a modified page, you have exclusive ownership of it and you can do reads and writes to it. If you have a shared page, that means this is a page that is shared with other nodes and you cannot write to it. It is write protected. And finally, an invalid page, which is somewhat of a misnomer, I think, just means that the page is not in the page table and you have to reach out to some other node for the latest copy of this page. And to offer this distributed shared memory abstraction, you have to very carefully follow a bunch of logic which intercepts reads and writes to pages in these states and correctly delegates either to the local memory manager or to the memory manager of a remote node. And that finally brings us to handling I/O. The way they handle I/O is that they capture all I/O interrupts and then forward it to the target virtual CPU, which could be a local CPU or a remote CPU. The authors have implemented this as modifications on top of QEMU and KVM in the Linux kernel, and it looks like their modifications were only about 7,000 additional lines of source code. They have a link to their GitHub over here. So that's not overly complex. That's a manageable amount of additional complexity. They have a bunch of benchmark results in here. They have some micro benchmarks which look at memory reads and writes compared to a local virtual machine, as well as mutexes and file I/O. But rather than focus on those micro benchmarks, I really wanted to focus on higher level application level benchmarks. The first benchmark they ran was StressNG, which is a collection of various programs. And the baseline is a single virtual machine, like I said. And on average, some ran faster, some ran slower. The average was, I think, about 1.3 times slower for giant VM across the entire suite. However, they have another benchmark for very large scale text processing, which I think is the more interesting benchmark. They perform two simple operations on a bunch of text, counting the words and building an inverted index. And the baseline they compare it to is performing those tasks on a Spark cluster. And this time, Giant VM performs much, much better, about 3.5 times better than the Spark cluster. So this is kind of the best case scenario for Giant VM because Spark has a lot of overhead managing I/O and distributing work across these clusters and then combining the results and so on. Whereas Giant VM is able to do it just as if it was one single machine with a lot of resources. It's important to point out one major shortcoming of this approach, which is that it is not fault tolerant, in the sense that if one single physical machine that is part of this Giant VM abstraction fails, then the entire Giant VM fails. There is no replication of data or memory across these systems. And I think this may be a major limitation of this entire approach. The sweet spot for using this might be old legacy applications like giant online transaction processing systems that really need to run in a single address space. They are really built as one monolithic application, but then they need increasingly expensive mainframes to run on. So you might be able to run them on the cheap if you are able to split them across machines using an abstraction like this. But as the number of machines, the number of physical machines underlying a giant VM increase, the likelihood of failure goes up, and it becomes harder and harder to offer a reliable abstraction. That is why you'll see most modern cloud applications take a slightly different approach, which is that they build fault-tolerant abstractions for each kind of resource. So, for example, you have S3 buckets or things like Spanner or the Google File System for replicated but reliable storage that is very fault tolerant. And then you build applications on top of those abstractions. So that was a quick look at Giant VM, which I thought was an interesting point in the design space of virtual machines. It tries to combine resources from many physical machines and then offer them inside a virtual machine to an application which uses them as if they were just within one single machine. I hope you enjoyed that, and I will see you next time. Thank you very much.